Hello friends, welcome to Mains Maxima, a dedicated program to maximize your mains marks. The question is, critically examine the recent developments in Indo-China relations in the light of Doklam standoff. We have to know about some important facts. We share more than 4000 km of boundary with China. Unlike with Pakistan, we don't have a real demarcation of boundary with Pakistan. India has line of control, which is a physical boundary, but with China we have a notional boundary called as line of actual control. So where is the territory, where is the boundary? This is something which is not yet resolved, and that is what is leading to a number of incursions. Way back in 1980s, there was an incursion in Samdorong Cho Valley, and subsequently in 2013 there was an incursion called as Depsang incursion in the Ladakh sector, and it was followed by Chumar incursion in 2014, and in 2017 there was a 73-day standoff between India and China with respect to Doklam issue. This slide speaks about the position of Doklam. It is an 89 square kilometer area which is disputed, and this is present in the tri-junction of three countries, China, Bhutan and India. So this is what is the Doklam. Doklam is very strategically important for India geostrategically, because if China is taking possession of Doklam, naturally this will cut off our northeastern population from the mainland India. We have only one connectivity to connect to our northeastern states, that is Siliguri corridor, or called as Chicken Neck corridor. So this will be severely affected. Our connectivity with northeast states will be severely affected if we cede Doklam to, or if Bhutan is ceding Doklam to China. Relationship is marked by cooperation as well as contradiction. Despite of this cooperation and contradiction, there is a huge potential present in the bilateral relationship, because the bilateral relationship is not unilateral. It is not unidimensional, it is multidimensional and multilateral as well. Economically, from the security standpoint, especially with respect to joint counter-terrorism strategies and also infrastructural connectivity, China-India relationship will have to be put on the highest pedal. The security aspect of India-China relationship will have to be seen first. We share more than 4000 km of boundary with China, which is characterized by a notional demarcation, not a real demarcation, and that is why it is resulting in a number of incursions. As said before, we have maritime dispute with respect to South China Sea, that China says the entire South China Sea belongs to China since ancient times, but India wanted right to passage through this South China Sea, which is very, very strategically located. And we have seen the Doklam issue as well as the Chumar standoff. Increased assertiveness of China in not just South Asia, but also in the Southeast Asian region. China wanted to become one of the superpowers in the world. It wanted to develop a G2 condominium with two power centers, one power center US and the second power center China. So it is having a big power ambition, which is what is reflecting in the assertivism, both in the land as well as in the sea. We have a boundary dispute in case of our west, Aksaichin region. In case of east, the entire 90,000 square kilometer of Arunachal is claimed by China, as it belongs to China only. So this is what is creating animosity in the relationship, especially territorial disputes. On the economic front, we have increasing trade deficit. Even though our bilateral trade is prospering, but more than 50% of our annual trade goes in the form of negative trade or trade deficit. Close to $50 billion India is losing because of its trade deficit with China. The reason is they are exporting capital intensive goods and we are exporting to China raw materials. Value-added goods will fetch more money for China in comparison to raw material or primary products which India is exporting to China. Also, $46 billion connectivity called as China-Pakistan Economic Corridor is passing through the disputed Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, and that is severely undermining territorial sovereignty, and that is the main reason why India do not want to become a partner to Belt Road Initiative despite of repeated invitation made from the Chinese side. China is a nuclear partner of Pakistan. Since 1990s, they have given nuclear reactors to Pakistan, especially the Chashma nuclear facility was provided by China to Pakistan. So they have a very strong nuclear cooperation. But Pakistan is not having a clean track record as that of India with respect to the nuclear non-proliferation. We know what happened with respect to the AQ Khan, Abdul Qadir Khan's nuclear black market. India is also not supported by China as far as its entry into United Nations Security Council with a veto is concerned. China's stand is China supports India's candidature as a permanent member in the UN Security Council, but without a veto. And similarly, India wanted to become a member of the coveted nuclear supplier group, and this is also obstructed by China. However, a number of measures have been taken bilaterally to improve the ties, given the immense prospects in the bilateral economic relationship as well as environmental relationship. Post Doklam, India has put the bilateral relationship on track with more sincere and cultivated efforts, because we don't want to have any sort of military confrontation with China, and that is why our measures are very sincere and cultivated in order to mend the ties between India and China. We also have given importance to the principle of mutual and equal security as well as information sharing mechanism. One of the main dispute which we have with China is the sharing of hydrological data. There is a suspicion that China is diverting the Brahmaputra river to feed the northern cities of China, which is facing water scarcity. The diversion of Brahmaputra has resulted in irritation in the bilateral relation. And in 2014, when our Vice President Hamid Ansari visited China to commemorate the 60th anniversary of the Panchsheel Agreement, both the sides have signed a water sharing agreement with respect to monitoring of the flow of water in relation to the Brahmaputra River, which is one of the important significant steps taken by both countries to resolve the water disputes between both the countries with respect to Brahmaputra, which is a lifeline for both the countries. China also helped India's effort to include Pakistan in the grey list of Financial Action Task Force. And our bilateral cooperation is very significant with respect to WTO, as we wanted to eliminate the trade distorting measures practiced by the developed countries. And there is also a positive relationship between both the countries in the field of climate change and sustainable development. India is stressing along with China to improve the people-to-people contact. Close to 500,000 Indians are going to China annually, and this is increasing day by day. And the Indian companies are starting their establishments in Chinese territory, and there is also Chinese companies investing in the Indian soil. So this speaks about a very positive economic relationship which is making appearance in the bilateral relationship. Now we'll come to the conclusion. There was an informal meet between the Prime Minister of India and the President of China in Wuhan in 2018, April. Both the leaders were sailing on the same boat on the East Lake in Wuhan, and both of them have reiterated their cooperation with respect to peace, prosperity, and development on reciprocal basis mutually. We also have underscored the importance of people-to-people contact, and India has coined a term called as strength to popularize, to intensify the people to people contact and the cultural contacts. The idea strength makes for the words spirituality. S stands for spirituality. T stands for tradition, trade and technology. R stands for relationship. E stands for entertainment. And N stands for nature conservation. G stands for sports games. And H stands for health and tourism. The next question is on Asia-Africa growth corridor. How it is different from that of the Belt Road Initiative? A small note on this Asia-Africa growth corridor. In 2010, a dialogue was institutionalized by India and Japan for development in Africa. Subsequently, when the Prime Minister of India visited Japan in 2016, the idea of Asia-Africa growth corridor got crystallized. And during the 2017 African Development Annual Meet in Gandhinagar, the Prime Minister of India announced the launch of this Asia-Africa growth corridor in partnership with Japan. We should look at how Africa is becoming very important in India's foreign policy. Speaking economically, the bilateral trade in 2005-2006 between India and Africa was just $11.9 billion. But after 10 years, 2015-2016, it has increased to $56.7 billion. So Africa is one of the indispensable economic partner for India. Now we'll come to the question, Asia-Africa growth corridor. We'll see the question, Asia-Africa growth economic corridor marries India's brand of human resource development and capacity building with Japan's objective of delivering quality infrastructure in the region. How far this can effectively counter the Belt Road Initiative of China, discuss by suitable arguments. An introduction should always speak something positive about the project or about the bilateral ties. Africa is geostrategically important for all countries, which is why all countries of the nation have kept Africa as a topmost foreign policy priority, especially with respect to access to raw materials, because Africa is having so much of raw materials and it is abundant in energy, and many countries are ready to invest in Africa. China has started heavily investing in Africa. Japan has started investing heavily in Africa. So has India also started heavily investing in Africa. And India has recently announced that they'll give a concessional line of credit to Africa, which is amounting to $10 billion. Now we'll speak about the comparison between the Asia-Africa growth corridor as well as the Belt Road Initiative. We should write that this is not directly a response to the Belt Road Initiative of China. This is not directly to counter the Belt Road Initiative, because there is a difference between these two projects in terms of the character, policy character, and the connotations of these two investments. Asia-Africa growth corridor is embracing some universal values with respect to human resource development. It prioritizes investment as well as development, whereas the Chinese project is prioritizing only the national interest. It wanted to economically exploit the resources present in Africa. So Belt Road Initiative is an investment which is having the component of exploitation of the nature or the resources, whereas India's initiative along with Japan is developmental with respect to the nature's preservation as well as the employment potential generation in case of Africa. So different objectives they have. One is national priority, another is the priority of the indigenous people, that is the African people, and priority of the sustainable development by focusing on human resource development. Next is where the funding is going to come. BRI funding is going to come only from government of China. They are going to take fund only from the Silk Road Fund or through some sort of collaborative measure which is giving more importance to the Chinese hand. So China may dominate economically through funding of BRI. But in case of Asia-Africa growth corridor, there is a private investment generation. There is also involvement of government as well as an international funding, especially from the African Development Bank and the Asian Development Bank. So as far as the motive is concerned, one is exploitative, another is developmental, and second is the funding is concerned, one is unilateral funding and second is multilateral funding with the invitation given to even private funding. Now, by focusing on sustainable developmental goal, Asia-Africa growth corridor will help in the priority areas like health, agriculture, agro-processing, skill development of the local population of Africa, pharmaceuticals, and tackling of disaster management issues apart from infrastructural facility. So we wanted sustainable development and we are focusing on human development resources through this Asia-Africa growth corridor. When it comes to BRI, BRI also says that the objective is development of the African continent. But however, we have seen that this Asia-Africa growth corridor is more people-centric, it is more democratic, unlike the unilateralism, a streak of unilateralism present in the BRI, as China wanted to influence unilaterally BRI. So, there is a consultative approach which we follow in the Asia-Africa growth corridor, but there is no such democratic consultation mechanism present in the BRI. Unilaterally, China decides with respect to BRI. Look at the China's Belt Road Initiative. It has a land component which is given in the red color and it is having a sea component. The land component is called as land connectivity component is called as Silk Road Economic Belt and the sea component is called as Maritime Silk Road MSR. Both sea and land component is what is present in case of Belt Road Initiative. So land connectivity as well as sea connectivity. When it comes to Asia-Africa growth corridor, Asia, Japan is getting connected to Africa, so as India is getting connected to Africa. So this is what is a potential connectivity in the name of Asia-Africa growth corridor. India, in fact, is ready for cooperating with the like-minded countries in order to develop socially, economically African continent. And we are employing democratic process in the development, unlike the investments made by China, which is only causing resentment amongst the local population. The conclusion should be, the Asia-Africa growth corridor foundation is based on power struggle over three things, that is infrastructure, investment and connectivity. Beyond doubt, there is a power struggle when we compare these two projects. In this power struggle, it is very clear that the India-Japan strategic congruence is clearly emerging in order to balance the Chinese influence as well as the Chinese flagship project called as Belt Road Initiative. So, latently or covertly, there is a power struggle present in the BRI, but in general, both the projects are speaking about development and the India-China project and the India-Japan project is more development with respect to the local population, and this will be helping transform the dark continent or the poorest continent, which is housing more than 50 countries in the world. India has expressed that India's partnership with Japan in Africa's development is tuned with the African Agenda 2063, a long-term objective of African Union. The African Development Bank chief notes that India's developmental assistance to Africa is a priority, a pleasure, and it will help in reconstruction of the African social political economy. Expressing happiness over India-Japan relationship in the developmental projects of Africa, the African Development Bank chief says the developmental projects of India and Japan in Africa is an example of priority, pleasure, and privilege as both are committed investors for the reconstruction of the African continent. Next question is on India-Pakistan relationship. We'll read out the question first. Examine the reasons behind increased tensions between India and Pakistan in the light of ceasefire violation. Also, discuss the measures to build peace process across the border. Now we'll start with an introduction. This is what is the introduction. Kashmir is an unfinished agenda, and this is a main source of unremitting hostility between these two nations. There are a number of reasons for the historical hostilities, which may span from water dispute, terror attacks, ceasefire violations, and these ceasefire violations have taken the center stage recently. Increasing attacks, especially the Uri attack, Parampore attacks, and the death of a number of military as well as civilian population across the borders. So this has resulted in manifestation of tension in the bilateral relationship. What are the reasons for the increased tensions? Underline the keywords present. We have asked you about the reasons for the increased tensions. Write the reasons for the increased tensions. China factor is one of the important factor which is causing thorn in the relationship between these two nations. For example, the $46 billion mammoth infrastructural connectivity called as China-Pakistan Economic Corridor is passing through the Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, which is a territorially disputed site between India and Pakistan. So this has resulted in a number of security manifestation and apprehensions in the Indian side, which is one of the important thorn in the bilateral tie, that the close proximate relation between China and Pakistan, which is ranging from economic relation, political relation, nuclear relation, as well as the military relationship. Then Kashmir factor, which is not resolved in the last 7 decades, and that Kashmir factor is resulting in escalated insurgency with the jihad infiltrations, the region becomes very fragile in terms of security. One important turning point in the bilateral relationship was the announcement of ceasefire agreement in 25-26-2003, because increasingly in the years 2001-2003, there were so much of, infiltrations, there were so much of cross firings between the security personnels, and this has to be traced to the 1999 Kargil war and the resulted escalation of the tension. If we look at the first 5 months of this year 2018, record break ceasefire violations have been reported in both sides. For instance, official sources indicate 1,252 ceasefire violations by Pakistan and 1,050 ceasefire violations by India, resulting in heavy casualties, both the military as well as the civilian casualties. However, recently, the Director General of Military Operations of both sides have decided that they will fully implement the ceasefire understanding of 2003 in both letter as well as spirit. And this is seen as a huge relief because of the escalation of the tension between these two nations in the recent times. Now, what are the other reasons for the strained relationship? The role of Pakistani military in spearheading anti-Indian rhetoric. We know that unlike India, there is only controlled democracy in Pakistan, where the civilian government is under the control of the army. So it was the army which infiltrated the Indian territory in the Kargil incursion 1999, even without the knowledge of the civilian elected government. Lack of economic opportunity in case of Jammu Kashmir is resulting in these youths of Jammu Kashmir, they are easily rented out by the insurgent groups, and that is what is causing a number of problems in the border areas. And in this context, the Home Ministry of India announced a new scheme called as Udaan scheme for skilling the educated unemployed youths in Jammu Kashmir. And as of 2007, it is found that more than 10,000 youths were trained under this Udaan scheme, and the government also has notified that this Udaan scheme is going to continue till December 2018. and a number of security concerns related to counterfeiting of currency, and there is also drug trafficking along the borders. Also, geopolitical reasons have escalated the tension. For example, US aid is cut to Pakistan. US was giving aid to Pakistan in order to dismantle the terror outfits. But since Pakistan could not act decisively, it could not fulfill the promise of dismantling the terror outfits, that US has suspended the aid which it is giving normally to Pakistan. Also, because of India's initiative, Pakistan was placed by the Financial Action Task Force under the grey list for failing to curb anti-terror financing. Not the first time Pakistan was put in the grey list by FATF. Even between 2012 to 2015, Pakistan was under the grey list of the FATF. Now, what are the peace-building measures which would bring cordiality in the bilateral ties? Creation of family bunkers along the international borders. For example, a number of villagers were the affected victims of the indiscriminate firing by the armies, and that is why they have to be moved to the safer places, they have to be secured. So creation of family bunkers becomes very indispensable today to protect the villagers. The director generals of military operation will have to hold meeting regularly, because it is a fact that whenever the DGMOs meet, naturally the ceasefire violations have reduced in the past. This will definitely help in the reduction of the ceasefire violation. Meeting, regular meeting between the director generals of military operation, and establishing more flag meeting points between the local commanders in order to remove the misperception, misunderstanding, and it will equip better communication. We can also suggest using advanced technology like drones, thermal imaging, in order to identify the ceasefire violation and take corrective measures. We also will have to get the active support of the regional groupings like SAARC, SEO, to pressurize Pakistan not to involve in the ceasefire violations. Most importantly, to enhance people-to-people cooperation, we have to provide mutually on reciprocal basis liberal visa regime. We know that there was a historic bus journey by the Prime Minister, the then Prime Minister of India, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, in 1999. A very famous Lahore Declaration was made in 1999, but the Lahore Declaration spirit and letter was sabotaged by the military because of the Kargil attack. In fact, this Kargil crisis has resulted in both the countries coming to the brink of a nuclear conflagration. However, there is much scope for resurrection of India-Pakistan relationship. Why? Because it appears that there is a growing feeling in the Pakistan military establishment that permanent enmity with India has only resulted in counterproductiveness. So enmity is counterproductive, and they wanted to effect a course correction. The military establishment wanted to come closer to India. So we can even mature to talk about a military cooperation with Pakistan, not military confrontation. So a phase change can be effected from military confrontation to a military cooperation between India and Pakistan. Now, what is the conclusion which we have to write? Both of the South Asia's nuclear countries should settle their disputes with a conflict resolution framework. So negotiated settlement, arbitration, conflict resolution will have to follow non-violent methods. This will not only bring peace and stability in the region, it will also bring prosperity to the people, because it will enhance people-to-people contact. We can also bring revival of cross-border sport exchange rather than cross-border terrorism. We can bring revival of cross-border sport exchanges, especially cricket and hockey. We can also improve our bilateral trade with Pakistan, because the bilateral trade is abysmally low with our neighbor. Now, time has come that both the countries will have to show some statesmanship. We have to forget the bitter past so that we will move towards a bright future, a better future. Now this slide we have given about the China-Pakistan economic corridor, which is not liked by India because it has so much of security manifestation. China-Pakistan economic corridor is starting from Kashgar in China. It will connect Gwadar port. So this is a very important project which has been undertaken by China, which is not in the interest of India. Now look at this map. We have given the India-Pakistan border. This is what is Aksai Chin. This is what is the territory of dispute between India and China. And you have this Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. So the CPEC is passing through the Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, and that is why we cannot accept this, as it will erode the sovereignty of Indian nation. So this is the line of control, a real line which is drawn, unlike the notional line which we have drawn between India and China. This is a real line, but the main problem is ceasefire violations are taking place, leading to immense casualties. Thank you.